The future of air power is here and now. A quiet revolution is changing the way modern wars are fought. Such technology-driven changes are few and far between. The use of accurate rifles, exploding shells, iron ships, tanks, and blitzkrieg warfare are among the most significant. The military have a special name for these events: revolutions in military affairs.
In my lifetime, I can name three specific elements of revolution in military affairs. One is the radar that was developed by the British. Another revolution in military affairs occurred in the 70s and early part of the 80s, and that's stealth technology. And I would say the third revolution in military affairs is the unmanned aerial vehicle.
The modern-day international UAV phenomenon is seeing countries from around the world write the next chapter in the history of aviation. These changes are the biggest thing to happen to aircraft since biplanes were armed and turned into weapons in the First World War. The unmanned aerial vehicle, or UAV, signifies the next evolutionary change in the history of warplanes. It is a major technological leap forward to rival the jet engine, supersonic flight, or even air combat itself. But what are these aircraft, and what makes them so unique?
UAV is an unmanned or uninhabited air vehicle, and is defined as something that doesn't have a person actually in it flying it.
UAVs can be passive observers or armed and aggressive hunter-killers. They are a vital asset to the war fighter.
The modern-day UAVs can be completely autonomous. We can actually program the computers on board to start up, taxi out, take off, fly a mission, come back, land, taxi in, and shut down.
The unmanned air vehicle concept is nothing new. In 1896, the steam-powered Aerodrome No. 5 flew for 1 minute over America's Potomac River. During the First World War, the American automobile engineer Charles F. Kettering built the Kettering Bug, which was a 300-pound flying bomb. In the 1930s, the RAF flew remote-controlled Tiger Moth biplanes for gunnery practice. It was the construction of such target drones and the development of their control systems during the 1940s and later that led to more advanced and better controlled drones. In the 1960s, the US military realized the true potential of these unmanned aircraft when they were sent to the skies of Southeast Asia.
By and large, some of those UAVs were converted targets, target drones that were converted to do reconnaissance-type missions.
The United States Air Force had been using jet-powered target drones called Firebees to train its fighter pilots. However, instead of just being used to train for combat, the Firebees took part in it. Fitted at first with basic photographic reconnaissance equipment, and later purposely redesigned, they were able to undertake valuable intelligence missions over well-defended enemy territory.
I think we began to appreciate, at least in America, the tremendous leverage we get out of UAVs, actually in Vietnam. We saw that we could launch UAVs from C-130 and recover them. They were able to go downtown Hanoi and take pictures in a very heavily defended integrated air defense area and basically bring back pictures that would give us context to where the targets were and where surface air missile systems were being located.
Every successful mission brought back vital photographs about the enemy's capability and defenses. By the end of the war, the military realized how vital UAVs could be. However, the real proving ground of UAVs were not the skies over Vietnam. but on the other side of the world, in the sands of the Middle East.
The 1973 Yom Kippur War marked a real shock for the Israeli Air Force. And the main result of that war was that it forced Israel to look at UAVs.
Knowing the havoc the Israeli Air Force could inflict on their armies, the attacking Egyptians and Syrians placed surface-to-air missiles along their front lines. Acting as a protective shield, these air defenses took a terrible toll on the Israeli jets.
Around one-third of those aircraft that were committed were lost.
As the losses mounted, American Phantom jets were flown direct to Israeli air bases to bolster their rapidly dwindling air force. Although the Israelis were the eventual victors in the Yom Kippur War, their air force had paid an unacceptably high price.
The great lesson there was for the Israeli Air Force, which until then in history had not experienced defeat. So rather than risking expensive assets, what it did was it said, we must invest in unmanned systems.
Learning in part from the American UAVs, the Israelis soon adapted the pilotless aircraft to suit their own needs. Israel's wars have been restricted to the same relatively small zones, and this has meant their UAVs could be engineered to be less complicated and fly shorter range missions. Yet could these simple designs, powered by piston engines and looking like remote-controlled model airplanes, ever hope to pass the ultimate test of combat? By the early 1980s, Israel's northern neighbor, Lebanon, was in the grip of a bloody civil war. To add to the fighting, Lebanon had become the base of the Palestine Liberation Organization, or PLO. Israel's most dangerous and persistent foe. Also, Israel's old adversary from the Yom Kippur War, Syria, had placed surface-to-air missile batteries in Lebanon's Bekaa Valley. On the 6th of June 1982, Israel entered Lebanon with over 60,000 troops and 1,200 tanks in Operation Peace for Galilee. In the skies above, Israeli jets stood by to offer ground support. Meanwhile, in the Bekaa Valley, the Syrian missiles silently waited for their prey.
Operation Peace for Galilee really was the culmination of 9 years of very careful UAV development by the Israelis. And the UAVs in that air war played a crucial role.
With the jet losses from the Yom Kippur War haunting the military, the Israelis had invested time and resources into their UAV program. Developing reconnaissance capability, effects on tactics, and integrating the UAV to the military had all been undertaken. Its place on the battlefield was about to be put to the test.
The way the Israelis used their UAVs was very clever. They used them to decoy. They used them as close-in jammers, so they put jamming equipment on them. They used them in terms of surveillance. They used them for spot reconnaissance, they used them to direct artillery, and they used them to direct airstrikes.
As Operation Peace for Galilee progressed, the UAVs proved their worth, such as in the role of artillery spotters, when they could tell commanders how accurate an artillery barrage was. Yet it was against the Syrian missile sites in the Bekaa Valley that the UAVs had their biggest victory. Thinking these small and simple propeller-driven planes were actually Israeli Air Force jets, the Syrians thought they were under an air attack.
Now these UAVs droning all over the valley forced the Syrians to open up their SAMs and switch on their radars, and so that all of the positions were given away.
Just like an electric handheld torch needs to be turned on to look for something in a dark room, a radar missile sight needs to be switched on in order to find its target. However, like the torch, in doing so, it gives its location away.
And within 10 to 15 minutes, 19 of those 23 SAM sites have been taken out by a combination of airstrikes and artillery and special forces. So there, the UAV played a key role in what was really, it is the joint operation that is used as the benchmark, I suppose, for all subsequent operations.
So effective were the UAVs in fooling the Syrian air defenses that it's rumored that one UAV had no less than 28 surface-to-air missiles fired at it. All missed. The Israelis could not have wished for better results.
They were the first to kind of realize that if they put an unmanned system in there, it could trick the air defenses to being able to come on and reveal their positions and not have to put their expensive aircraft at risk for that.
With the surface-to-air missile sites destroyed, the Israeli Air Force was able to operate with impunity. Syrian jets soon fell easy prey to the Israeli Air Force.
The exchange ratio there was 80-0. The Israeli Air Force was able to shoot down just about anything that was thrown at them in that very limited operation.
I think that conflict really illustrated the use of UAVs and the value that they can bring to the warfighter. In fact, it was very soon thereafter, in 1985, that the United States bought the Pioneer UAV system from the Israeli Aircraft Industries. And we've had that system ever since and have deployed it numerous times, and it has taken, or it has participated in numerous actions around the world.
The Pioneer basically is a very simple UAV. It's fixed wing, it's got a rear-mounted engine, it's very capable of carrying a sensor package that allows it to be able to spot targets, to be able to identify those targets, to be able to auto-fix those targets, and pass that information off to some kind of direct or indirect fire support system.
The Pioneer does not have conventional takeoff from a runway, or in the case of naval ships, from the flight deck. Instead, it is catapult launched or rocket launched. For ship landing, it flies into a net. For the United States Navy, this means Pioneer can only operate on some of the larger ships or carriers.
We deployed it aboard our what we call L-class ships, our big deck helicopter carriers and troop carriers, as well as in Operation Desert Storm aboard battleships.
Battleship launched UAVs during the Gulf War, and specialist systems like the British Army's Phoenix system means there is no longer a necessity for dangerous forward artillery spotting techniques such as the low-flying Bird Dog of Vietnam, which saw many pilots and planes lost to hostile fire. Like Operation Peace for Galilee, the Gulf War was to be a rite of passage for the Pioneer.
It wasn't too long after the whole Desert Storm operation began that the Iraqi troops understood that when they heard this little buzzing airplane overhead, that very soon thereafter, either artillery or air-launched ordnance was quickly inbound.
In 1991, U.S. Navy ships were stationed in the northern Gulf of Persia to bombard coastal and inland targets in Iraqi-occupied Kuwait. It was in this lethal attack that, thanks to a UAV, combat history was made. In between salvos fired on Failaka Island by the battleship Missouri, a group of Iraqi soldiers heard and then saw Pioneer Air Vehicle Number 159.
When these particular troops heard a Pioneer UAV overhead, they wanted to make sure that we knew that they didn't want any artillery or other types of ordnance inbound. So they put up a white flag, surrendered. The Marines moved in and took them as prisoners. Probably the very first surrender to an unmanned aerial vehicle in combat history.
Throughout the Gulf War, a total of 313 Pioneer missions totaling almost 1,000 hours of flight time were flown. Throughout all these sorties, only one Pioneer was shot down by the enemy. The video sensors that showed the accuracy of shell fire or surrendering Iraqis were important tools for the ground or ship-based commander. Although an integral piece of the unmanned aerial vehicle, video cameras are only a small part of the modern UAV's sensory development.
In Vietnam, the UAVs, the reconnaissance capability they had was that of taking still frame photographs, which had to be taken back and then processed. When we come on to Israel, the reconnaissance capabilities we see there are real-time visual intelligence, so television pictures being streamed, only for daytime and only in good weather.
By the time of the Gulf War, there had been a significant leap in terms of the sensory capability carried by UAVs, which allowed for operation in many conditions.
We see the requirement for all-weather imagery, what we see then is electro-optical systems, infrared systems, synthetic aperture radar, as well as the video streaming. So we see all weather, all day, all night, all conditions.
With its array of sensors, the UAV is the perfect aircraft to undertake reconnaissance missions. More importantly, it takes away the need for combat jet aircraft to be converted for an unarmed reconnaissance role.
Reconnaissance was a tough problem for the military. They had to take tactical airplanes that carried weapons and put cameras in them, which meant they weren't weapons carriers anymore. And it was becoming an unpopular sport.
An unarmed aircraft could be easily shot down by an interceptor. Another difficulty of jet aircraft reconnaissance is the speed the aircraft travels. A concealed target may be missed by a single high-speed pass.
Typical tactical reconnaissance zips through at the speed of heat, and either they see it or they don't see it. But when you put an airplane up for long periods, you see a lot of things happening.
The new breed of unmanned air vehicles built for such reconnaissance came as a result of the Israeli and Gulf War UAVs.
General Atomics had a desire to get into the UAV business and put together a demonstration airplane, which we call the NAT-750.
The NAT-750 was built and made for America's Central Intelligence Agency to monitor and provide close-up details of the fighting that was taking place at the time in Yugoslavia. By the mid-90s, the NAT was flying over Yugoslavia at altitudes of almost 10,000 meters for up to 30 hours at a time. The success of the NAT led to the evolution of a new UAV. The name of this new and improved aircraft was Predator.
Predator first deployed to the Balkans in about 1995, early in 95.
The capabilities of the Predator gave the combat commander a clear picture of enemy ground operations. Its capabilities are so high that it can spot a person from almost 90 kilometers away.
What Predator did was provide real-time video to operational commanders so they could see the target, they could practically watch the bombs dropping on the target, and when the smoke cleared, they had instant bomb damage assessment. In the past, you'd have to believe the pilot who dropped the bomb as to whether or not he hit it or not, or you'd send a recce airplane in to get a photograph of it. And that's typically time late by the time you see the photo.
A time late piece of intelligence is one that is no longer accurate. A group of tanks or some troops may have moved away by the time a photo has been displayed and assessed. Adding to the ability of the Predator is SAR, or Synthetic Aperture Radar. SAR cameras can see through bad weather, light foliage, and sometimes even roofs. For the warring sides in Yugoslavia, this meant there were few places they could hide.
it started an awareness that they never had before. You could watch the war on television.
However, now the Predator is hunting for a new enemy.
We're probably not seeing the traditional threat. We're seeing an asymmetric threat. We're going to be fighting in cities and shadows and caves.
After the terror attacks of September 2001, the attention of the world turned to the Al-Qaeda terror group. Basing themselves in remote valleys and barren wastelands of Afghanistan, and having no massed troops or armor, Al-Qaeda made for difficult-to-find targets. Yet the Predator, with its ability to stay airborne for 40 hours, has been perfectly suited to exposing the enemy as he tried to hide in the vast wilderness of Afghanistan.
Things that the UAVs have been doing, the Predators, in terms of finding targets, is they have been feeding live streamed video to AC-130 gunships.
And now an AC-130 inbound to a target area actually sees the video of the target. The Predator's already identified it, giving him latitude and longitude coordinates and giving him real-time color video of what the target looks like. So when he gets there, he just shoots. He doesn't have to hang around.
Not only can Predator identify and locate targets with its streaming video, a precision laser targeting system is the next trick up the Predator's sleeve.
The current operational Predators can go out there and put a laser spot on a target so that a tactical airplane can come in and drop a laser-guided weapon on that spot.
With the avoidance of collateral damage being the priority for military commanders, politicians, and the public, such precision targeting by the Predator helps ensure that it's the enemy and not the civilian in the line of fire.
Now we're fighting an enemy that's going to be operating in caves, in cities, and shadows. So we want to make sure that we're able to overfly wherever the belligerents happen to basically situate themselves, even if it's next to non-combatants, and be able to separate the good guys from the bad guys.
The sensory system that helps locate and destroy targets is not the limit of the Predator's capability. The Predator can now destroy targets on its own.
The weaponization of UAVs is a very controversial subject. And there are not only doctrinal issues, there are legal issues involved. UAVs, depending on how they're viewed, could be basically covered by the missile technology control regime.
With various treaties limiting the world's arsenals, it was feared that an armed Predator could be deemed an illegal type of missile.
We signed the missile technology control regime. The big difference between a UAV and a missile is an unmanned aerial vehicle is able to be recalled. It basically is programmed by a man in the loop to allow you to use the vehicle in certain kind of situations and return it to its home station.
Predator was designed to be an ISR asset, intelligence, surveillance, reconnaissance, and it was only later in the program did they decide to put weapons on it so that if it detected a target of interest that was time critical, where you didn't have time to get manned aircraft with or artillery or some other type of weapon on that target, that the Predator would have some capability immediately then to take the target out.
The war on terror spurred the military to arm the Predator with the Hellfire air-to-ground missile. This transformed the Predator into a deadly weapon. Yet where could this combination be tested?
When was the first time the Hellfire was used in combat? It was in the Afghan campaign.
Designed for low-speed, low-altitude aircraft, the Hellfire was the natural choice for the Predator.
Predator is a key player in the war on terrorism. In fact, since last September, there have basically been two Predators airborne over Afghanistan every minute of every day.
The Predator is not the only UAV veteran of Afghanistan. Flying at almost 20,000 meters and acting as an even better and even more precise set of eyes for the US military is the jet-powered Global Hawk.
It was an idea to see if we could take the man out of a high-altitude reconnaissance platform and basically do the same kind of mission.
The presence of Global Hawk over Afghanistan has given commanders a view of the battle area as never before. Flying at twice the height of commercial jet airliners, the 35-meter wingspan Global Hawk can scan up to 120,000 square kilometers. Even from its lofty height, Global Hawk can distinguish different types of vehicles, aircraft, and other targets. Whereas the Predator can search an area, Global Hawk can scan an entire country.
We are overwhelmed with success that Global Hawk has been able to achieve. It's a very stable platform. Recently, it has flown up to 18 different sorties in Afghanistan.
The Global Hawk's ability to stay airborne and loiter for up to a day at a time means that surveillance and reconnaissance can be maintained around the clock.
The essence of this kind of capability is that the enemy has no place to hide.
The level of automation on the Global Hawk means that it is effectively on perpetual standby, to go wherever it is needed.
As we embrace this global war on terrorism, we would like to think that the Global Hawk can basically be deployed to any place in the world in a matter of hours.
With the ability to fly to any part of the world on its pre-programmed systems, the Global Hawk is extremely versatile. Once on station in a particular airspace, the Global Hawk can then automatically take up a flight path and constantly monitor the ground below. Not only does this allow the military a greater freedom to operate UAVs in armed as well as reconnaissance roles, it also means that with the world's news cameras forever watching, the consequences of losing an air vehicle are considerably reduced.
So our major kind of weakness in a lot of these instances is that, you know, we don't want to put a life at risk or allow them to capture a body and use that against us.
The real benefit of a UAV is it takes the man out of harm's way.
What we're striving toward is to be able to take the if necessary part away and say it is no longer necessary to risk a life for these particular missions.
In 1995, when F-16 pilot Captain Scott O'Grady was shot down over the Balkans, the safe return of this one pilot after a six-day search and rescue crisis was celebrated as a massive military and political triumph.
If you look in a paper and a Predator goes down or a Global Hawk goes down, it makes the news for a little bit and then it goes away.
Not only are UAVs safer and keep the pilot out of harm's way, they're smaller and cheaper to build. Also, the costs associated with pilot training are much less than they would normally be.
The training can all be done on a computer, and if we have automatic takeoff and landing systems, then the training requirements to even make that operator skilled enough to do these operations and then to maintain his proficiency are dramatically reduced.
Although someone with no flying experience could train to fly an unmanned aerial vehicle in a relatively short space of time, trained pilots are the preferred choice.
I think we would start with pilots, and the main reason is we believe you need some sort of air sense to be able to operate these initially, and the only system we have to produce that is the same one that produces pilots through pilot training. There might be folks whose eyes have gone a little bad or wouldn't be active pilots, but had that kind of air sense.
UAVs need pilots to guide them remotely through a mission. But there is a more advanced type of unmanned air vehicle waiting in the wings, These vehicles do not require pilots. They're called UCAVs, or UCAVs.
UCAV stands for Unmanned Combat Air Vehicle. It's being designed from the beginning to be a survivable weapons carrier.
Using advanced computerized technology nicknamed SMARTS, which act as an onboard pilot, means UCAVs can be very independent, unlike the Predator.
Predator is a single remotely piloted vehicle that you put a weapon on. A UCAV is trying to take a jump from that in the command and control systems that it uses.
Instead of an operator moving a joystick to avoid anti-aircraft fire, the UCAV's SMARTS would automatically command defensive maneuvers. Such technology makes it more independent and survivable than other UAVs.
One of the big differences that UCAV does bring in is it is not a remotely piloted vehicle. A lot of the things that are out there now in unmanned systems, like the Predator, are actually flown.
The Gnat and the Predator are flown from a ground control station. Joystick and other inputs are entered at the ground control station by a pilot sitting in a control console. The UAV then changes its altitude or adjusts its speed accordingly. A UCAV, however, has the ability to fly and complete missions autonomously.
Autonomous means that an air vehicle can conduct its entire mission without an operator telling it what to do.
In battle situations, they can constantly assess the combat area and even alter or expand on their original mission.
If it senses new threats or if it determines that there are higher priority targets, it, with its own decision-aiding logic, can decide to dynamically retask itself.
The highly computerized UCAV can assess what the threats are or if it needs to go after new targets. The UCAV can react to situations on its own. Boeing's X-45A is the leading UCAV.
The X-45A, for all practical purposes, is a manned tactical aircraft without the pilot.
If you look at the X-45A, the inlet is in a place where normally we would put the pilot.
With pilots out of the aircraft, UCAVs can take full advantage of having no pilot on board.
Just from the fact that you're removing the operator from the vehicle itself, you probably save anywhere from 30-40% of your weight. You don't have to put in ejection seats, you don't have to put in the oxygen systems and other protections. The other thing it gives you is you don't have to design the airframe around the person.
Theoretically, we can design a UCAV to be able to pull 20 Gs, 30 Gs, whereas typically a manned tactical fighter might be limited to 8 or 9 Gs simply because of the limitations on the pilot himself.
The gravity, or G-force, pulling on the human body during a high-speed turn can make a pilot lose consciousness. A UCAV could have levels of maneuverability impossible for a pilot to endure. Its entire construction no longer needs to compensate for the presence of a pilot.
When you design an unmanned system, it's really targeted at the mission that it's got to perform.
With no pilot, the military would have no hesitation in sending the UCAV ahead of manned aircraft.
The X-45 is designed to be able to go and attack. In that particular role, one of the things you are trying to be able to do is go against the air-to-ground threats.
The X-45's mission would be to spearhead a future air attack. By taking out the most dangerous missile sites, manned aircraft could then fly in with a greatly reduced risk of being shot down. The jet-powered X-45 and UCAVs of the future have a performance and flight capability ideally suited to their planned role.
The primary role, as I see it, for UCAVs in the high-intensity warfare will be the suppression of enemy air defenses, or SEED as it's known.
The UCAV is designed to go against a more demanding and more advanced adversary and go into the teeth of his enemy air defenses.
The reason that UCAVs are earmarked for this role is we have a lot of potential enemies which are equipped with what are called double-digit Russian-made or Russian-designed surface-to-air missiles.
Modern surface-to-air missiles are incredibly fast and have enormous range. Missile sites in hostile countries could attack aircraft as they take off from Air Force bases or even from carriers. The potency and effectiveness of such weaponry dictates that an unmanned system goes in first, and that no life is unduly put at risk.
Going against those sites is a very demanding and dangerous kind of mission. Technology is evolving with UCAVs to give us the ability not to have to put people in harm's way.
And this is where the stealthy high-tech UCAV such as the Boeing X-45 can get in there, can get in close before it's detected, and can take and find and take out those systems.
Although the X-45 UCAV is a leap in terms of air power and military technology, it borrows many ideas from what has come before it. One military concept incorporated into its design is stealth technology.
When we talk about UCAVs, we're really talking a specific kind of unmanned aerial vehicle that's specifically designed to be stealthy.
Stealth technology is not being invisible as an airplane. It's just having a low radar cross-section.
Stealthy aircraft have bodies and flight surfaces that minimize the amount of reflected radar energy. Some materials in the aircraft's design actually absorb this energy. The overall effect of this means the aircraft has a very small radar signature or footprint and is hard or impossible to detect. If an aircraft can't be detected, then no missiles can be fired at it.
Stealth technology will continue to play an important part in UAV and UCAV design where those UCAVs are designed to go into high-threat areas. So only where you're using those systems in the first few days or even first few hours of a high-intensity war.
With stealth helping the UCAV go deep into enemy territory without detection, there is another aspect of military technology the UCAV has incorporated to aid its mission. The precision weapon.
Now let's get to a definition of precision weapons. In the past, we used to say something was precise if it could hit within 100 meters. Today, we say it is a precision weapon if it can hit in less than 7 meters, and we're even refining that definition if it can hit within 3 meters.
The concerted use of precision weapons dates back to the Vietnam Air War, when bombs used a laser beam to highlight and make their way to a target. The first big success of these bombs was in 1972, with the destruction of the Dragon's Jaw Bridge. Yet it was not until the 1991 Gulf War that the world saw the true power of these weapons.
If you kind of compare what we did in Desert Storm to World War II, what we were able to do with one airplane in Desert Storm, it would take approximately 2,000 airplanes, missions and sorties in World War II.
Unlike the massed air raids of World War II, precision weapons remove the need to saturate an area with powerful bombs in order to destroy a target. Now, with bombs becoming more and more precise, and by using the Global Positioning System, or GPS, one relatively small bomb from one aircraft can destroy a target. This type of bomb is called the small diameter bomb.
The small diameter bomb started with the recognition that the ordnance itself doesn't need to be that large in order to inflict damage on a particular target.
It allows you with a smaller bomb bay area to have fewer weapons on board and achieve a high level of probability of kill with fewer weapons. And so what you're doing is you're trading actual high explosive weight for accuracy. So you don't need a big as weapon because you can hit it more accurately.
Another key feature of it is because the warhead is smaller, we're able to constrain the damage to highly localized areas and therefore reduce unintended damage to other sites, particularly like urban environments.
It allows you, as we say in the trade, to go downtown, one look, one shot, one kill.
With the technology in place, the missions of the future can be formulated.
You might have actually several of these UCAVs flying in formation, doing a coordinated mission.
A small formation of UCAVs could have several dangerous targets in their sights.
We're going to actually launch four UCAVs in a swarm. So four UCAVs each being able to carry eight munitions apiece, that's 32 different targets.
Not only can they send information to a control base, but also to each other.
They're trading information among themselves, they're reacting dynamically to the battlefield environment, and they're also changing the particular roles and missions that each vehicle is doing in this multi-ship formation among themselves.
The actual mothership who's controlling this group of unmanned air vehicles would stay behind and send in these unmanned combat air vehicles to a highly lethal integrated air defense system.
With its primary mission completed, the UCAV could take up another role.
After they've gone through, they may set up orbits to do a more reactive kind of protection role. The manned package comes in. If some defenses are out there that were missed and start to come up, then the UCAVs help suppress those defenses, again allowing the manned force to be able to again hit its targets and then be able to safely come back out again.
The highly capable UCAV has its current mission sights set on destroying enemy air defenses. But what is the next step of this amazing journey? The F-22 Raptor and F-35 Joint Strike Fighter are at the cutting edge of jet fighter technology. Both have a stealthy configuration and carry precision weapons. But the offensive capability of UCAVs is now almost equal to theirs. Are these two aircraft the last of the manned fighters?
We didn't have these capabilities in the 80s and even in the early 90s. So now that the technologies are coming together, we're able to move forward with a level of unmanned aerial vehicle that we could only imagine 10, 15 years ago.
But at some point out there in the distant horizon, if your time horizon is long enough, there's nothing to preclude unmanned systems ultimately also being able to do air-to-air missions.
If the 20th century was the pilot century, could the 21st belong to UAVs? UAV development has mirrored the evolution of First World War biplanes. At first just used for reconnaissance, they eventually became purpose-built weapons of war. The UAV transformation to UCAVs has followed the same path. But where will it ultimately lead? Will the dogfights of the future stop being man against man, but instead become man versus robot, or even robot versus robot?
Sometime out there in the future, it's quite possible that we could have a robotic air force.
Despite the impressive abilities of the UAV and UCAV, it is ultimately infantry who fight in the latter stages of a war. However, with the help of a UAV, the ordinary foot soldier is about to become extraordinary. The UCAV, or Unmanned Combat Air Vehicle, has an undeniably high level of sophistication and potency. However, no war can be fought and won from the air alone. Although the aerial bombardment of Iraq during the Gulf War was very effective, it was conventional ground forces, as in all wars, that ultimately brought that conflict to a close. While the UAV and UCAV is able to assist with spotting and striking targets that may threaten troops, ships, or other aircraft, there is one more thing that can give a soldier the edge over his enemy, the micro UAV.
They come in very small packages that are man portable in a backpack and are designed to only look around the corner or maybe to look you know, into the second floor window in an urban warfare type of environment.
In World War II, the vicious fighting that tore into the cities of Stalingrad and Berlin illustrated how complicated, confused, and treacherous urban warfare could be. With every building being a potential enemy stronghold, an army can soon become bogged down in a bitter and bloody struggle for every scrap of rubble.
If you're in that kind of area and you are in a building and you need to see around the corner, rather than stick your head around the corner and get it shot off, you can launch one of these little UAVs and it will fly around the corner like a bird or like an insect and take a look for you.
By relaying images to a screen, micro UAVs with autonomous capability could not only help a platoon of soldiers, they could also act as long-standing and discreet intelligence gathering stations.
We're talking about something that would maybe have like 1.5 kilowatts of power that could basically just watch for a month. It maybe could transmit for a week. It could basically act as your eyes and ears looking at a particular building and collecting information and templating patterns, scenarios, if you will, of perhaps terrorist activities.
A micro UAV could fly secretly into a hostile nation, and there it could gather valuable intelligence. In this role, it could discreetly transmit information about movements of urban-based terrorists or build-ups at military bases. Yet a micro UAV can be even smaller.
UAVs in general can be very small. In fact, there are micro and mini UAVs that weigh ounces and can be carried in the backpack of an individual soldier.
In the UAV context, we have micro UAVs that can fly around in the room.
Miniaturized and sophisticated micro UAVs could not only infiltrate enemy locations, but sensors could detect explosives as well as chemical, biological, and nuclear threats. The possibilities are limited only by the imagination of scientists.
There is really no practical limit into the smallest size.
From the skies over the jungles of Vietnam to the sands of the Middle East and through the barren mountains and valleys of Afghanistan, unmanned aviation has not only surprised and impressed the modern military commander, but also, and more importantly, his enemy. Large operations and aspects of current and future campaigns can now be done via remote or even autonomously. The risk to human life, military and civilian, is diminishing all the time. Now information can be as valuable as military might. And complicated intelligence gathering operations deep inside hostile countries could be undertaken by something carried in a briefcase. All this is in stark contrast to the way aircraft were greeted at the start of the 20th century. These new, ramshackle, and flimsy flying machines were scoffed at by the military leaders of the day. In 1911, the French commander General Foch said, "Aviation is good for sport, but for the army, it is useless." Whereas military aviation was once sidelined and held in low regard, it has since developed into a potent force and is now the preferred mode of attacking an enemy. With unmanned combat air vehicles, the military in years to come may find themselves in strangely similar circumstances to their counterparts 100 years ago. No manned warplanes and no pilots. Where sending men into battle was once the norm, in a couple of generations, it may have become all but memory.